Hello everybody, in today's lecture we'll be talking about biosafety and environment and why it is important to follow the biosafety regulations in order to protect the environment. Biosafety is a term that is used to describe those policies and procedures put forth to ensure the environmentally safe application of modern biotechnology. This term biosafety is not something new. This has been around for as much as 30 years now. And it was for the first time introduced in the Convention on Biological Diversity, that is CBD, which was signed at the Earth Summit in the year 1992. However, this CBD came into force only in the year 1993 on 29 December. Also, as a supplement to this CBD, there was a Cartagena Protocol on Biosafety, or the CPB 1993, which aimed at protecting biological diversity from the risks posed by genetically modified organisms, and also ensuring adequate level of protection during the transport, handling, and use of these GMOs. Furthermore, the Cartagena Protocol looked forward to control the adverse effects on sustainable use of biodiversity, which primarily took into consideration the human health and the effect of modern biotechnology on human health. This Cartagena Protocol emphasized on decisions which were made on the basis of scientific risk assessment and precautionary principle. Now, talking more in detail about the Convention on Biodiversity in 1992, the main focus of this agreement was to focus on conservation and sustainable use of biodiversity. Also, it was put forth to recognize the potential of modern biotechnology in causing harm to human well-being, while also taking into cognizance the serious impact of modern biotechnology on environment and health. This convention emphasized the need to regulate the risks which are associated with the use of living modified organisms, also known as the LMOs. And it was here that a stage was set to bring about a legally binding international instrument about biosafety. As of today, talking about the status of regulations across the world, most industrialized countries have biosafety regulations already. Which include most of the OECD countries, or the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development countries, because OECD is a major regulator of biosafety and scientific practices that are associated with modern biotechnology. However, a majority of developing countries do not have a regulatory or monitoring procedure yet. This is mainly because of the lack of financial support, enforcement systems, and also inadequate institutional capacity. However, there are a few countries which can be considered as notable exceptions. They include India, Mexico, and the Philippines, who have established regulations and incorporated them in the national laws. Now, moving on to Environmental Impact Assessment, or the EIA. This was a concept that was first adopted in the United States of America in the early 1970s. This was when it became clear that certain projects carried out as biotechnological ventures were having undesirable and unforeseen impact on the environment. The EIA can be defined as a process designed to ensure that potentially scientific and significant environmental impacts are satisfactorily assessed and taken into account in the planning, design, authorization, and implementation of all relevant types of actions. So here what happens is, the group which is assessing the environmental impact would take into consideration every aspect of that product or a project, either of it, be it a product or a project, and check out on how it can have an impact on the environment. And this process involves an analysis of existing environmental conditions also, which is run parallelly alongside an assessment of the significant impacts of the proposed action upon the existing environmental conditions. So this is something very dynamic, because the current environmental situation is always taken into consideration while assessing the impact of a plan. When we say biosafety associated with modern biotechnology, the most important component of biotechnology that is taken into consideration here are the genetically modified organisms. These organisms will have three different types of impacts on the system. These three types of impacts are called the direct, the indirect, and the secondary impacts. While the direct impact deals with the biological, ecological, and evolutionary aspects which will define the scope of biosafety, the indirect impact will look into the consequences of the development of new technology, while the secondary impact will analyze the sociological and socio-economic value additions that are related to the development of this new technology. So in general, when we say impact, it is not necessarily a negative impact. An impact could be positive as well as negative. So we do not categorically say genetically modified organisms can only cause problems to the environment. They could also be doing good. And all of which has been classified as direct, indirect, or secondary impacts. Now talking about the direct effects or impacts, genetically modified organisms will lead to creation of new weeds. Also, gene transfer may be found occurring between species which are of wild variety. And this gene transfer is usually mediated by hybridization and introgression, where introgression means the possibility of the transfer. Nextly, there could be creation of biological vectors which may have undesirable properties and lead to a potential for disease. In today's condition, if, although I may not categorically say because it is still not sure, if the coronavirus was something that was developed in a laboratory, it is an obvious outcome of modern biotechnology. And we can see the undesirable properties of this virus and its potential to cause a disease and damage the global economy. Likewise, there could be a lot of those genetically modified organisms that are there and that are existent amongst us and that have such negative effects on the biodiversity in general. Nextly, there could also be disruptive effect on ecosystem due to an introduced trait to favor the evolution of new pests or disease agents or even affect the entire ecosystem process, where the wild varieties may lose their capacity to do a lot of things independently and depend on biotechnology for their survival. And lastly, genetically modified organisms may have a direct effect to the non-target species, where they can harm these non-target species. This happens when the negative effects of the introduced trait is transferred to other species, such as a beneficial insect that feeds on plants, and also the worker safety. This is what we call as bioaccumulation. We are using a pesticide or a pest repellent, but are we taking care to make sure that these pest repellents affect the pests only and not the beneficial insects or the workers who are working in that particular facility? No. So there is a possibility of negative impact on these organisms which are actually striving to help that plant grow. Now moving on to the indirect effects. Use of genetically modified organisms will lead to reduced need for chemical inputs, and it will also result in reduced pressure on the natural habitats by alleviating the pressure for the conversion of wild lands and pastures to increase productivity. So what is happening here is the small piece of land where the genetically modified organism is grown would be sufficient to give a good yield, and this will discourage the destruction of natural habitats and conversion of wild or forest land and pastures into farmlands. Also, genetically modified organisms by the intervention of science can help in speeding up reclamation of the damaged or destroyed habitats as well. Then we have the secondary effects, where the society is impacted by the genetically modified organisms. Here, since we are using genetically modified crops, they are less labor intensive as that of the wild varieties. So the labor requirements come down. And also, a large amount of yield can be obtained from a small farm. So it will have an impact on the farm size also. And since there is a great amount of yield, there is significant supply that is maintained and the demand is met. Thereby the pricing of such products are also very affordable as compared to those yield obtained from wild varieties or the native varieties. Now, getting into the aspect where we question ourselves why biosafety regulatory mechanisms are important. And this is a question that has to be taken in the global level, where such biosafety regulatory mechanisms will assist countries in understanding the issues that are involved in their R&D development and also identifying their own interests. The best example for this is Green Revolution that happened in India, where we Indians or the Indian government then could understand the involved issues of food safety, where not much food was available to all its population in any event, or in case of any war or famine or drought. So, our interest was in improvising our food safety and security measures, and we sought the help of biotechnology to carry out Green Revolution and achieve this interest. Nextly, it also helps in identifying harmonization systems which facilitate thorough and speedy reviews of the applications. Because there has to be a stipulated protocol to be followed for such reviews of applications. And having a set of biosafety regulatory mechanisms will lead to harmonization of this stipulated protocol, which will be uniformly followed throughout, across the country and across the timeline, depending on the requirement. And this will also build the human capacity for those responsible to implement such systems. Because if you have a stipulated biosafety regulatory mechanism, people can be educated with that. And the people who are governing will have the necessary capacity to implement such regulations. So with this, I would like to conclude today's lecture. Thank you all.